Simon & Schuster Audio presents One World, Ready or Not, The Manic Logic of Global Capitalism by William Greider. Read by Howard McGillin.
Imagine a wondrous new machine, strong and supple, a machine that reaps as it destroys. It is huge and mobile, something like the machines of modern agriculture, but vastly more complicated and powerful. Think of this awesome machine running over open terrain and ignoring familiar boundaries. It plows across fields and fence rows with a fierce momentum that is exhilarating to behold and also frightening. As it goes, the machine throws off enormous mouths of wealth and bounty, while it leaves behind great furrows of wreckage. Now imagine that there are skillful hands on board, but no one is at the wheel. In fact, this machine has no wheel, nor any internal governor to control the speed and direction. It is sustained by its own forward motion, guided mainly by its own appetites, and it is accelerating. This machine is our subject. Modern capitalism, driven by the imperatives of global industrial revolution. The metaphor is imperfect, but it offers a simplified way to visualize the drama of a free-running economic system that is reordering the world. The logic of commerce and capital has overpowered the inertia of politics and launched an epoch of great social transformations. Settled facts of material life are being revised for rich and poor nations alike. Social understandings that were formed by the hard political struggles of the 20th century are being put in doubt. Old verities about how nations rank are being revised, and a new map of the world is gradually being drawn. These great changes are sweeping over the affairs of mere governments and destabilizing the established political orders in advanced and primitive societies. Everything seems new and strange. Nothing seems certain. Economic revolution, similar to political revolution, liberates masses of people and at the same time projects new aspects of tyranny. Old worlds are destroyed and new ones emerge. The past is upended and new social values are created alongside the fabulous new wealth. Marvelous inventions are made plentiful. Great fortunes are accumulated. Millions of peasants find ways to escape from muddy poverty. Yet masses of people are also tangibly deprived of their claims to self-sufficiency, the independent means of sustaining hearth and home. People and communities, even nations, find themselves losing control over their own destinies, ensnared by the revolutionary demands of commerce. The great paradox of this economic revolution is that its new technologies enable people and nations to take sudden leaps into modernity, while at the same time they promote the renewal of once forbidden barbarisms. Amid the newness of things, exploitation of the weak by the strong flourishes. The present economic revolution, like revolutions of the past, is fueled by invention and human ingenuity and a universal aspiration to build and accumulate. But it is also driven by insecurity. No one can be said to control the energies of unfettered capital, not important governments or financiers, not dictators or Democrats. My central message takes the form of a reasoned warning. Our wondrous machine of capitalism, with all its great power and creativity, appears to be running out of control towards some sort of abyss. Amid revolutionary fervor, this warning may sound far-fetched and, as history tells us, will usually go unheeded until one day, sometimes quite suddenly, it is confirmed by reality. To understand this machine, you must see the awesome variety of people who are engaged by this economic revolution. Across nations and industrial sectors, from Eastern Europe to Asia, from aircraft to semiconductors, from peasants entering industrial life for the first time to the most exalted realms of finance. As the following scattered glimpses will show you, the symptoms of upheaval can be found almost anywhere, since people in distant places are now connected by powerful strands of the same marketplace. As enterprise opens up new territories, the maps keep changing. It has already become commonplace to speak of one-world markets for everything from cars to capital. The Earth's diverse societies are being rearranged and united in complicated ways by global capitalism. The global system of trade and production is fast constructing a new functional reality for most everyone's life, a new order based on its own dynamics and not confined by the traditional social understandings. People may wish to turn away from that fact, but the only option people really have is to catch up with the reality. The only way to escape the sense of helplessness is to confront this new world on its own terms and try to understand its larger implications. We can do this by taking the machine apart, breaking it down to its underlying mechanics, and explaining how it really works. The actual system does not conform to the economic theory it presumes to follow, nor are people and nations powerless to influence its behavior. To make these matters visible, we'll roam selectively around the world, both to savor the human variety and to illuminate the system's realities. This inquiry is organized into three distinct but interconnected realms: the industrial system of multinational production, the global market of finance capital, and the altered social reality for both rich and poor. The present-day upheaval is fundamentally similar to the great industrial revolutions of the past, yet distinctive in its size and scope. At its outset, the English Industrial Revolution launched in the late 1700s, steam power, steel, mechanized textile looms, the first railroads, involved a handful of cities and probably at most a few hundred thousand people. This revolution counts recruits in the billions. In China, as the November days turned crisp and cold, the citizens of Beijing shopped at sidewalk markets for the traditional supplies of winter cabbage. Farmers hauled cabbages into the city every day, stacked on trucks, bicycle-powered wagons, and overloaded handcarts. The ritual reflects a national memory of poverty and famine. Every autumn, a family acquires its store of winter cabbages as insurance against the ancient threat of scarcity. You can see the cabbages hanging atop communal walls or outside apartment windows, their outer leaves blackened by Beijing's sooty air. As usual, McDonald's was already there, already selling burgers to consumers. From Kuala Lumpur to Moscow, the company acts like an advanced scout for the global revolution, somehow able to detect the emergence of rising disposable incomes before other firms see it. Chinese buy their winter cabbages and also fast food. McDonald's measures its market potential with numbers like these. In the United States, there is a McDonald's restaurant for every 29,000 Americans. In China, despite rapid expansion, there is one McDonald's for every 40 million Chinese. When I visited Bangkok, Thailand, the newspapers were preoccupied with the melancholy saga of Honey, a work elephant who was severely injured when a truck sideswiped her on the highway. As doctors tried to mend the elephant's smashed hip, contributions poured in from heartsick citizens, including the king. Elephants have been the emblem of Thai culture for at least seven centuries, but are now gradually dying out. Honey's death prompted editorial reflections on the price of prosperity. The new national symbol of Thailand, you could say, is the traffic jam. Bangkoks are the worst in Asia, citizens remark, with an air of disgusted pride. Their daily commuting routines are the longest in developing Asia, and people manipulate schedules endlessly to try to avoid the hours of steaming tropical congestion. The problem is that Thai people are buying cars much faster than the government is building a modern transportation system. When I was in Poland, the newly chartered Warsaw Stock Exchange was underway in a stately old pre-communist building. Trading was quite thin, since only two dozen companies had their shares listed, and Poles were already experiencing the turbulence of Adam Smith's The Invisible Hand of the Market. Stock prices rose fabulously in 1993. Then, the stock market crashed the following spring. As shares fell 40 to 70% in 10 days, the Polish traders adopted the style of gallows humor familiar to mature financial markets around the world. A broker observed,
"We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.